happy birthday this week to Roger Smith and Jan Avera, and a happy birthday, happy anniversary, big thing, to Charlie and Dee Payne. The flowers gracing our sanctuary this morning are given to the honor and the glory of God, and in loving memory of Myrtle Rob Waters' birthday by her family. Wow, those colors are crazy. You will find attendance books at the end of each row. Please take a minute and sign in so that we can keep accurate records. Marvin ringers will practice in the bell room at 4. Kids and youth will have snack meal at 5:30 in the gym, and then split off for their own activities from 6 until 7. Important note, the second payment for you who have signed up for this year's summer trip is due. The amount is $62.50 per child. There will be a staff meeting this Monday morning at 9 in the fellowship hall. This Wednesday, March the 1st, we will have food pantry from 9 to 10, and then we will have our first Lenten luncheon in the fellowship hall at noon. The chancel choir will be hosting, and all are invited to attend. Many blessings will be received along with food and fellowship. Bring a friend or two with you. Choir practice will take place at 5:30, and cantata practice will be at 6 in the sanctuary. Youth craft night will be from 6 until 7. Next Sunday, March the 5th, our UM Men's Club breakfast meeting will be at 8:15 in the gym. Our communion rail offering will be going to UMCOR for Turkey and Syria Relief. Our Marvin ringers will practice at 4 in the bell room, and kicks and youth snack meal will be at 5:30 in the gym with their regular program from 6 until 7. UM Duck will meet at 10 in the fellowship hall on Monday, March the 6th. Then our second Lenten luncheon will take place on Wednesday, March the 8th at noon in the fellowship hall hosted by the Young at Heart. There is a Lenten luncheon schedule insert in your bulletin. Hold on to it so you can keep up with the dates and the speakers. Wow, that's a lot of information. So keep up with the sheet of paper, I guess, and everything else, and check your bulletins, because there's obviously a lot going on. Are there any other announcements that need to be made? If not, let us quiet our hearts as we prepare for worship, and may the Lord be with you.
Thank you. stand with these, we join together and sing our call to worship. And change my heart, oh God, so thank you, 152, other things we sing. Cannot understand your plans or your ways, but we can trust in your ruling power, in your holiness, in your love, and in your goodness. Let us fix our eyes on you this morning, safe in your presence, because we know you care. And it is in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. Opening hymn page 365, Grace Greater Than All Our Sins.
Blessed are those who the Lord does not hold guilty, and in your spirit there is no said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and he forgave my guilt of my sin.
Therefore, let those who are godly offer prayer to you.
At a time of distress, the rush of great waters shall not reach them.
You are a hiding place for me. You preserve me from trouble. You encompass me with deliverance.
I will instruct you and teach you the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye on you.
Do not be like an unruly horse or a mule without understanding, whose temper must be curbed with bit and bridle.
Many are the pangs of the wicked, but steadfast love surrounds those who trust in the Lord.
Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, O righteous.
Shout for joy, all you upright in heart.
Gracious Lord, humbly we come before you, acknowledging the source of all good gifts. And Lord, as we give back, we know that you have the grace to multiply what we give. Let it further your kingdom here on earth and us in your service. In Christ's holy name, amen. Amen.
Thank you.
short confession of the Christian faith.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you. Please do be seated. So good to see everybody this morning. Blessings as we begin the season of Lent. We think about the things that we're grateful for and that we give thanks to God. I give thanks to God for Jamie Jameson. I don't know if y'all noticed the nice sign that we have out front that invites people to come join us on the season of Lent. Jamie is so gracious to share his gifts and his graces and his talents. And when we sit in business meetings and Kim's there, we're like, is there just somebody that can make a sign? He gets thrown under the bus a lot. Appreciate you. It's a beautiful day today. It's easy to give thanks to God, and it's easy to celebrate. It's times like this, you need to take a little bit of the sunshine and just tuck it away in your heart, because when it gets dark and cloudy, we've got to be reminded the sun still shines, even when we can't see it. God is still with us. So what else are we giving thanks to God for? What are we celebrating?
Kind of self-serving, but I'd like to for Doug's niece.
All right. She doesn't have her own identity. Doug's niece. Doug's niece, everybody. Talent over here, too. To have people to lead us in music. It's real good. You know, seminaries are putting out preachers all the time, but having somebody that can really lead you in spiritual music is a true grace. So we are grateful, Sarah. We appreciate you. It's Carrie, too. What else are we celebrating? Old friends? Yes, sir?
It's good to have family in Bruce and Megan and Laura in from Pensacola to spend a weekend with us.
It's always good to have friends and family visit. Don't forget to give thanks to all the good things.
We're glad Marla's back this year.
Yes, we've been missing Marla and Ada. Both been out. One reason or another, but back. So, just take some time sometimes and just count your blessings. Give thanks to God for all the little things. Because there's a lot of, if we start talking about the things that weigh heavy on our hearts, we're going to be here for a long time. We are going to lift that up, but we want to continue to remember Mike. Mike's going to be starting chemotherapy again, and continue to remember Ella as she takes care of him. We've got a lot of changes with our senior adults. Miss Hope Nicholson has gone home with the help of hospice, and of course James and our own Dee are right by the bedside taking care of her. So Dee, you're in our thoughts and prayers there. Bud Singletary, who's our oldest surviving World War II veteran, was active in World War II, is now up at Highland Home Rehab, and trying to get him strong enough to come back home or to do something different. But just continue to pray for the family as they make those tough decisions. Anybody ever been in a place where you got to make tough decisions for your seniors? That's a unique, hard place to be. Just keep them in your thoughts and in your minds. We have a lot of folks that we haven't seen in a while. Don't forget about all of our homebound, and especially the folks. And we can name folks all day long, but remember, we're bigger than this building. We're bigger than this room. We're bigger than those that are gathered here. And as we pray, our prayers go out. And don't forget to reach out with cards and with phone calls and let them know you're there too. You help me. What have I forgotten? Who else are we praying for?
Phil.
Thank you. Continue to remember Phil. And she doesn't want to talk about it, but Miss Ann started her first radiation treatment. And everything's looking good. Yes, ma'am. Continue to remember Maggie McKee. I haven't seen her in about 3 weeks, but she's on hospice. We're doing good. I'm going to try and catch her this week. I've got some Sunday school books to use. Anybody else? Continue to pray for our nation. Continue our soldiers in harm's way, our situation over in Ukraine. The Methodist Church is present in the Ukraine. Methodist Church is present in Poland and Finland and all the areas around there. So we pray for our denomination. Let's pray for each other. And as we pray, the Lord be with you. Forgive us when we take it for granted, as we are mindful that around the world there are Christians that actually gather in secret because it's illegal to be a Christian where they are, and they do literally confess the crime that they believe that Christ is Lord. But Lord, for us that have this privilege, give us the strength and conviction every day to share the light of your love in everywhere that we go. Lord, there seems to be so much darkness and confusion and brokenness in this world, and it's easy to go dark and to respond evil with evil. But Lord, let us respond to the darkness with the light that comes from you. Give us the strength every day to find forgiveness and love, even when folks want to find meanness and anger. But Lord, sustain in us that clean heart, that new and right spirit that only comes from you. And even on this season of Lent, as we begin this walk holding your hand, we know we walk in the valleys and shadows. But Lord, we know we can do it because your strength goes with us. Lord, for all those we've mentioned and those that we've left unmentioned, we pray your Holy Spirit, your healing graces, and your loving peace just walk with them. Lord, when we can't do anything else, we unite our voices together, praying the prayer that you taught us when you said, "Saints, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Yeah. choir. That was fun. I've got two scriptures I want to work with. We'll eventually get to Matthew chapter 4, and if you want to take your finger and put it in Matthew chapter 4, we'll get to that last. But first, we're going to turn to Genesis chapter 3. And we're going to read some scriptures that a common theme of the season of Lent is temptation. These are scriptures about temptation and the nature of sin. And so this is where we begin the season of Lent. And I don't care what Dave Martin says, Lent is not about the stuff in your belly button. It's about a Christian tradition. Of course, Lent is an old English word that literally means spring, but in the season of spring, we come up to the time of resurrection, we remember the 40-day period. It is a wilderness period. 40 is a spiritual number. And 40 is a special number about, like, it's a time where people are kind of off doing something different. It's a time of introspection. It's a time of change. It's a time of looking at yourself. So even as we talk about how long did it rain on Noah? 40 days, 40 nights. There's a 40. How long did they wander in the wilderness? How many years? 40. Now we're going to read the scripture about how Jesus was tempted in the wilderness for 40 days. But before we get there, let's look a little bit about the original sin. The original temptation in Genesis chapter 3. Starting in verse 1, now the serpent was a little bit more crafty than all the other wild animals the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat from the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden. You must not eat it or touch it, or you will die. You surely will not die, the serpent said to the woman, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some of it and ate it. And she also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. And the eyes of both of them were open, and they realized they were naked. And so they sewed fig leaves together, and they made coverings for themselves. I'm not going to read any further, but I encourage you to read the rest of that. I think we all know how they were cast out of the garden because of their disobedience and because of their sin. But don't forget about the temptation. Now we also want to read from Matthew chapter 4. And this comes right after Jesus' baptism. You know, the season of Epiphany is about Jesus' baptism. And so we close that and we begin Lent, which is about the temptation. Chapter 4, starting in verse 1. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted by the devil. And after fasting, how many? For 40 days and 40 nights. He was hungry. And the tempter came and said to him, if you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread. And Jesus answered, it is written, man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. And then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. If you are the Son of God, he said, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands, and so that you will not strike your feet against the stone. And Jesus answered him, it's also written, do not put the Lord your God to the test. And again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all of the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. All of this I will give you, he said, if you will bow down and worship me. And Jesus said to him, away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. And then the devil left him, and the angels came and attended him. Beloved, it's the word of God for the people of God. Let the people say thanks.
Thank you, God.
Lord God, there's a lot of temptation in this world, and there's a lot of opportunity to go astray. In this season of Lent, be a rock for us. Be a place of refuge that we may always look to you and find our strength. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. So a big theme of Lent is temptation. And the temptation leads to sin. And as we think about what is temptation, what is sin? I think that if we were to go with sin specifically, there's a lot of different kind of definitions of sin. We might say sin is simply about the Ten Commandments. If we keep those Ten Commandments, then we're good with God. But Scripture also says no one is righteous. No one is perfect. And if we were to really live into that, none of us could be perfect before God. So we need something else. The temptations are what draws us away from God, draws us away from being trusting in Him and being dependent upon Him and really realizing that He's the potter. We are just clay in His hands. Look at the stories of temptation with Jesus. There are three of them. Three is another great number in the Bible. It means perfection. It means wholeness. And so every time that things happen in threes, it's kind of a perfection and things. Jesus is tempted three times. And He's off in His own way, and He is fasting. Fasting is another theme of Lent. Fasting is about when we deny our bodies something physically so that we can grow spiritually. I've said it many times. Remember that you are created a spiritual being. First and foremost, in the image of God, you are spiritual beings. But we're also put in this physical shell. And the physical shell has needs, and the physical shell falls apart, and the physical shell is always wanting something. But in the season of Lent, we deny ourselves physically that we can grow spiritually. And so that's what Jesus was doing. He wanted to grow closer to God. And He went off, and He denied Himself physically. And He was, guess what? Hungry. The temptation was, go ahead and take care of that physical body. Jesus, you've got the power. You've got the power to do this. If you just speak to those stones, they'll become bread. But Jesus understood that the spiritual issues were more important than the physical. Man does not live by bread alone, but by the holy word of God. And so Jesus passed that test because He turned away from the physical things that were calling Him astray and trusted in the spiritual. There's a lot of physical things out there. There's a lot of things calling to us, saying if you'll just buy us, you're going to be happy. If you buy the new big screen TV, you're going to be happy. If you're going to buy the new shotgun, you're going to be happy. If you're going to buy the new dress, you're going to look gorgeous. All these things, and, you know, we all kind of have our own different temptations. Mine might be that high. You've got to ask your own self with God what's calling you to lead you astray. The physical can sometimes take the place of the spiritual, and that's where it becomes a sin. But then after that, there's another temptation. The devil takes him out and he shows him this high pinnacle. Throw yourself down. If you are the Son of God, let me tell you what the Scripture said. Satan quotes Scripture. He will command his angels concerning you. They will lift you up on their hands so that you will not strike your foot against the stone. Satan's quoting Psalm 92 here. Go back and read it. But you know what? Anybody can take Scripture and quote it out of context. And there's a lot of bad preachers out there that can do this too. We can be tempted as preachers to preach what we want to preach. All we have to do is find an idea. This is my idea, the way I think the world is. And I'm going to go through the Bible and find every scripture I want to support my idea. We call that proof texting. When you're listening to preachers on the radio or whatever, pay attention to how many times they'll go through and they'll read one scripture out of this one, then they'll go get another one, then they'll go get another one. All throughout the Bible, they'll find that one piece of scripture that supports their own thoughts. And we can be really in danger of that because what Satan doesn't talk about is a bigger context of Psalm 92 is that when we are dependent upon God, when we realize that we're not in control, that's when God takes care of us the most and lifts us up and takes care of us. And so the temptation is, you know, if you just do this, God's going to take care of you, but that's not what the whole scripture says. Go back into the mid-19th century, a lot of preachers were preaching a lot of things from the book of Judges or the conquest of Canaan. Why? Because what were we doing? We were going out into the west, and there were those Canaanites. We called them Apaches or Navajos, and we took their land, as the preacher said, go in the name of. Then, even later on, in the 1850s, with the Slave Recovery Act. There were many preachers that loved to preach Philemon about go home slaves to your masters. And you see, there's a temptation to take the scriptures out of context and make it say what you want to say. And that's not just preachers. We all like to do that. We all like to find faults with somebody else. We'll pick a scripture about sin, don't we? And say, look at that sinner over there. And we forget that what we really need to be looking at is ourselves. We want to talk about everybody else's sin, but we want to forget about how Jesus died for all. We want to talk about how everybody else is wrong, but we don't want to talk about how we forgive as we are forgiven. And so we have to be careful to realize that we don't put God to the test, but we've got to give it all back. In the season of Lent, we do this. And the final test, the final temptation, is how Jesus is led up to this pinnacle, and he looks out over all the kingdoms. And as Satan has control over all the world, he says, if you'll just bow down to me, I'll give you power over everything. I'll give you power over you. You can control everything. Woo! Wouldn't we like the power and control? If you just go over to the donut shop early in the mornings and watch those men sit around the table, they'll fix the world. They got every answer for everything. If I just had the power, I could do that. I could make it right. And sometimes maybe we do feel like we've got power, and we can get a little bit uppity, we can get a little bit overly righteous to where we want to lord that power over somebody else, and we forget who really has the power. We can do this in a variety of ways. We can do this with our theology. We can do this with our Bible, even as we want to approach scriptures. But we can also do it in our social life. And we can try and make gods of just about anything that's out there if we put our trust in something else. Sometimes we might put our trust in something we might buy, or put our trust in a pickup truck, or put our trust in guns, or we might put our trust in the way we look, or we might put our trust in money and power and prestige. There's a lot of things we can put our trust in. There is only one God. We can get to be a little uppity sometimes. I remember, I usually try not to get too political, and by political I'm talking about college football. I've been pretty good about saying that I love all the Mississippi teams, but now y'all know I got a son up at Ole Miss, so my political leanings are a little bit towards Oxford. And anyhow, as the football team, we're doing really good, and Ole Miss is going to the Sugar Bowl, and I like Florida. Pick on some folks. And so here's my text to Tim Parker. Tim, you remember this? On, what was it, Thanksgiving Day, the Egg Bowl. And I text Tim Parker, oh, it slid down, let me get this right. And I text Tim Parker, "Hotty Tiny, let's go Rebels." And then I went, "Oops, sorry, wrong person." Tim, in his gracious and loving, kind way, said, "No worries." And then after the game, he says, "Hail State!" Bet you don't accidentally text me again. The heart of Lent, you see, is really realizing that we are not in control. God has always been in control. It's not about us having power over things. It's about how God works through his powers in us. We look back at the original temptation story. Adam and Eve were in the garden. It was perfect. That was the original relationship, the great relationship. But they didn't have anything to do. They didn't have to work. They just named the animals. That's all they had to do. Everything was provided for them. Eat from anything. It was all great. But one tree. Don't eat from that. Because if you eat from that, you will die. Romans 6 says, the wages of sin is death. And I don't see death in this instance as being the physical death of the body, but it's in the separation of God. Our temptations want to pull us away from God. Our sin separates us from God and from each other. And so what is the temptation the serpent offers the fruit? If you eat of this, you will what? Be like God. You'll know good from evil. So here we sit. We want to, anything that our bodies and our physical nature wants, we want to fill that with something else. Here we sit. We want to use our scriptures to lord it over others rather than to reflect upon our own sins. And here we sit. We want to have control over all this crazy world and all the things that's going on, and we'll grab a hold of anything except for prayers in our own hearts to let it go and let God. In this season of Lent, we are invited to let go and let God as we walk through Jesus in the wilderness. We have some crosses up front. We had these out for Ash Wednesday. You're welcome to come get one and take one home. The green ones are handmade by our youth, and we appreciate our youth as they gave of their service and their talents. And you know, we just need little reminders. That's what Lent is about. It's just a little reminder. Maybe you take it, you put it on the dashboard of your truck, and get up and go to work. It's there to remind you. Maybe it's on your sink, or when you start putting on makeup, it's there to remind you. Maybe you put it in your book bags as you're going off to school, and it's there to remind you. Wherever, at lunch or something, just look to the cross and say a little prayer, because it's not about how great we are. It's about ultimately giving everything to Jesus. And in the end of it all, as Jesus set his face towards Jerusalem, he had an opportunity. Remember, he had the opportunity to take control. He had Peter with a sword who was ready to fight. He could take everybody down. He could have stood up with Pilate and said, "No, I didn't do all this," but he was quiet all the way to the cross. And even hanging on the cross between the two thieves, he said, "If you just say one word, we'll all come down from here." But he gave himself wholeheartedly to the process of who he was and who he was to be for the salvation of us all. In the season of Lent, we're invited to follow. And so I invite us to pray, and then after that, we will sing Amazing Grace. Oh God, you are our deliverer. As you led your people of old through the wilderness, brought them to the promised land. Guide us now as your people, the people of your church, that as we try and follow Christ our Savior, we may walk through the wilderness of this world and toward the glory of the world to come. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our closing hymn is about how that grace is amazing, page 7, or my dyslexia gets me, 378 in the middle. Let's stand and greet. Give you peace. But all God's children say,
Amen. Amen.